Okay, so we have seen how we can solve for an arbitrary linear first order differential equation. So we have seen that it's useful to first start with the homogeneous counterpart of the same differential equation, and then go to the more general inhomogeneous differential equation. Right, so in this lecture we will take a look at the solutions and discuss a couple of properties of these solutions. Okay, so we have written down the solutions and we know everything about the solution, right? So we know explicitly how to find the solution, at least formally. Now so there's a couple of properties which relate to solutions of first order linear ODEs. The first property is the solution of the inhomogeneous ODE is unique up to an arbitrary multiple of the solution of the homogeneous ODE, right? So there is this intimate connection between the solution of the homogeneous equation and the inhomogeneous equation, and this will turn out to be true even for higher order equations. And so we will return to similar ideas later on, right, when we look at more higher order differential equations. So let's go over the argument. Suppose you have two solutions. You have found y1 and y2 of x to be two solutions of your full inhomogeneous differential equation, right? So you are given the differential equation dy by dx plus p of x times y is equal to q of x. So y1 and y2 are both solutions. So you can write dy1 by dx plus p of x times y1 is equal to q of x, and likewise dy2 by dx plus p of x times y2 is equal to q of x, right? Since both of them are solutions of the ODE. Now if you subtract these two equations, right, so right hand side will go to 0. So you have this equation d by dx of y1 minus y2 plus p of x times y1 minus y2 is equal to 0. So immediately we see that in fact the difference of any two solutions of the full inhomogeneous differential equation is in fact a solution of the homogeneous differential equation, right? So which basically proves the assertion, right? So the assertion is that the solution of the inhomogeneous ODE is in fact unique up to an arbitrary multiple of the solution of the homogeneous ODE, which is another way of saying what we have just shown, which is that if you manage to find any two solutions, their difference necessarily must be a solution of the homogeneous differential equation, right? So it is here that the power of first of all finding the solution of the homogeneous equation and then using this as something free that can be added to your solution of the full inhomogeneous equation. So in general, finding the solution of the full inhomogeneous equation is a harder problem, right? So if you can somehow find one solution of that, right, if you want to find the general solution of this, which is a harder problem, what this tells you is that you can find a solution of the homogeneous equation and then you can just tag that along for free. So you see that if you are able to find one solution for the full inhomogeneous equation, if you added a solution of the homogeneous equation to it, or any arbitrary multiple of a solution of the homogeneous equation, that's still going to be a solution of your full inhomogeneous equation, because you are just adding zero to the right hand side and it remains unchanged, right? So the left, if you think of this d by dx plus p as an operator, it acts upon y1 to give you q of x, and then if you have managed to find some other the solution of the homogeneous equation, that can be added for free to a solution of the inhomogeneous equation, that will allow us to write down the full general solution for the inhomogeneous ODE. Right, this is a trick that we will use later on. All right, so it's going to become much more important when we do second order and higher order differential equations. Okay, so there's another property which we want to discuss. So, but before we discuss the second property, let's look at the concept of linear dependence of functions, right? So we have said that these functions can be thought of vectors in a vector space. We have also discussed the notion of linear dependence of vectors and so on, right? So let's just discuss linear dependence of functions. So functions f1, f2, so on all the way up to fn of x are said to be linearly dependent if you can find some set of coefficients, set of constants, not all of them zero, right? If all of them are zero, then that doesn't suffice. If you can find some non-trivial set of coefficients k1, k2, all the way up to kn, such that k1 times f1 plus k2 times f2 plus all the way up to kn times fn is equal to zero, then you say that these functions f1, f2, all the way up to fn are linearly dependent, right? So, and they are linearly independent if such an equation implies that all these coefficients k1, k2, so on are all zero, right? So there's only a trivial set of coefficients which will make this possible. If that is the case, then you say that these functions are linearly independent. Now, so if this holds, right, so there is a way to recast this condition for linear independence of such functions. If k1 this holds, then we can just take the first derivative. Then you get k1 times f1 prime of x plus k2 times f2 prime of x, so on all the way up to kn times fn prime of x is equal to 0. That's second equation. You can write a third equation, a fourth equation. So in fact, you have n different equations you can write down. K1 f f1 the n minus 1th derivative of x, so on all the way up to fn of n minus 1 of x, right? So there are going to be n equations. It's a system of n linear equations in n variables. So the k1, k2, all the way up to kn being the variables, right? So we know that if this determinant of this quantity is non-zero, then there is a unique solution for these k1s. So you can think of it from the Cramer's rule point of view. But even otherwise, we know that if this determinant is non-zero, right? So then, it immediately follows that these functions are linearly independent. Because if they're linearly dependent, then you will be able to find some non-trivial set of coefficients k1 all the way up to kn such that this condition holds, right? So this determinant is, there is a name for this determinant, and it's called Wronskian, right? So it turns out that this is a necessary condition, right? It's not it does not always work in the opposite direction. If the determinant of if the Wronskian is zero, you cannot say that the functions are linearly dependent, right? So, well, if the functions are linearly dependent, then the Wronskian is going to be zero, right? But on the other hand, the opposite way doesn't quite work. And so there is this property 2 that I want to discuss, but so we will see that. So we will talk about the Wronskian in a moment for this property 2. So the property 2 is that if you have a first order linear homogeneous ODE, it has only one linearly independent solution, right? So again, let's start with two solutions. Suppose there are two solutions, y1 and y2. Let's say there are two solutions of this differential equation. This is a homogeneous differential equation, so the right hand side is zero. So we have dy1 by dx plus p times y1 is equal to 0, dy2 by dx plus p y2 is equal to 0. So we can rewrite this as 1 over y1 times dy1 by dx is equal to minus p of x is equal to 1 over y2 dy2 by dx, right? So if you look at just the first, this part of this equation, so we see that immediately we can just integrate both sides. So you get log y1 is equal to log y2, right? And so plus a constant, and basically which in turn means that y1 must be equal to some constant times y2, right? So which is the condition that these two are linearly dependent, right? So if these functions are linearly dependent, so I said that the Wronskian is going to be zero, right? Because if the Wronskian is not zero, then the functions are linearly independent. That's what this condition is, right? Right, but there probably there will be a homework problem where you will be given a set of functions which are for which the Wronskian is zero, right, and yet they are linearly independent. So if the Wronskian is zero by itself, you cannot say whether, you know, the functions are linearly dependent or independent. But on the other hand, if the Wronskian is non-zero, then for sure these functions are linearly independent. So in this case, you see that we managed to show that in fact these functions are linearly dependent, and then you can verify that the Wronskian is zero in this case, right? So you, I mean, it's straightforward to see this, because, you know, basically the idea is the Wronskian is given by, in this case, f1 times, so y1 times y2 prime minus y2 times y1 prime, right, which is basically this condition. So you have y2 times y1 prime minus y1 times y2 prime is equal to 0, right? So indeed the Wronskian is of these two functions is 0. Okay, so that's all for this lecture. Thank you.